I once told my grandmother that I was getting my PhD in holding babies, to which she replied, "There must be something else that you do." My name is Kelley Gunther. I graduated from Penn State with my PhD in developmental psychology, and I'm currently a postdoctoral researcher at Yale. I study why kids become anxious. However, today, I want to talk a bit about what we can learn from holding babies. Papers in psychology include tens to thousands of participants, each representing a one-on-one interaction between an experimenter and an individual. But when you're studying development, the people that come into the lab to participate are infants and children. Imagine a life of group projects that determine your entire career, where your groupmates are all babies. So this has prompted me to think very deeply about who is included in research and what are the samples that inform what we know about the developing brain. So I've spent the better part of the last 10 years working nights and weekends to collect beautiful, brilliant, perfect data with one of our baby scientists or get vomited on by a 7-year-old. So people might ask, wouldn't this be easier with adults? That's an interesting point. But I've learned so much about child development and anxiety disorders through my work. Yet I've learned just as much about humans by working with the families that participate in research. Behind every data point is a person. We must work to get to know the people that inform our research just as much as we must work to specialize in the brain or behavior. So rather than expecting a child to do a task that we think will answer our research question, we must design a task to fit our participants. So, for example, say we're studying memory. With an adult, it's rather straightforward just to present them with some information and ask them, what do they remember? But for a school-age child, perhaps we'll make a computer game where they learn about different aliens and what planets they live on. Then later, they'll be asked to match aliens with their home planets by pressing buttons on a computer. The speed at which they reply tells us information about how well they remember that alien. And maybe we'll also collect some brain data while they do the task to examine what parts of the brain are working harder for different kids to understand why some kids might do better on the game than others. But a baby can't really tell us what they remember, and they certainly can't press a button to give us their answer. So we have to trick infants into showing us what they know. So we might do something like show a baby different pictures on a computer screen. We'll use something called an eye tracker, which is basically a fancy camera that tells us where they're looking on the screen. And then we'll use information about what a baby looks at more or less to tell us what it is that they remember and what they don't. Now, this might come as a surprise, but despite our best efforts, infants and children do not always follow directions. So we'll often wildly overestimate the number of families that have to walk through the doors of a lab just to complete a study. And even still, data collection includes multiple bathroom breaks, negotiating with goldfish, or taking some time to sit on the floor and discuss our favorite colors and dinosaurs, just to get through a study. So I've thought just as much about what Elmo video to play for a baby as much as I have about the brain circuits that might put an individual at elevated risk for anxiety disorder. I find this humbling. And so if we want to hear the voice of children and understand their development, that needs to be all children. Historically in the social sciences, there has been a focus on populations that we'll refer to as weird. This stands for white, educated, industrialized, rich, and democratic. So that means that the majority of research in children is actually centered upon the minority of the world's population. So why is this a problem? Not all babies are the same. They may grow up in different homes, with different resources, and in different families. And the environments that we grow up in and live in have a lot to do with how our brains develop. So babies from different environments may have slightly different brains. And studying one child certainly does not apply to all children. Also, research traditionally focuses on the communities surrounding universities due to convenience, which represents a privileged subset of the population. These are families that may work at the university or be familiar with research. So how can we fix this? First, we can build community partnerships to reach outside of the area immediately surrounding the university and ask families, what is it that you need to feel comfortable participating in research? As we work to engage families that aren't necessarily university affiliated, it may be their first time in a lab or on a college campus. So they may have woken up their child from a nap, put them in a car seat, driven to a new location, all to have to make small talk with a stranger, and then have their child look at pictures of aliens on a computer screen. This is a big day for anybody. And so we as researchers must adapt to meet children and families at their level of comfort and understanding, rather than expecting them to rise to ours. For instance, it's scary to see technology that you've never seen before, especially if someone told you that it's measuring your brain. For example, we might use an EEG cap to measure brain activity on your scalp, but that kind of looks like we're covering your head with 100 tiny suction cups. And then if we use an MRI to take a picture of your brain, if you've ever had an MRI at the doctor's, you might remember that they're pretty large and noisy. On top of that, we'll ask a child or infant to sit still while all this is happening? No, thank you. With all of this happening, our goal is to make people feel safe, heard, and understood. We can empower families to ask questions, but also give them answers that are accessible and understandable. Also, the child is always the boss. If at any point they're not having a good time, then data collection ends. Additionally, just as diversity is important in film and politics, it's critical to have diversity in researchers. That means having research staff who have shared identities and experiences with families. This allows us to do things like conduct research in the family's native language, which is so important in making individuals feel comfortable. It's also important for children to see scientists that look like them, opening the doors for the careers that they can dream of and aspire to. Adapting research to the children and their families who participate is not only out of respect, but it's also in the name of scientific rigor and validity. If people don't feel comfortable in a lab setting, they may modify their behavior, so the data we're collecting might not actually be accurately representing them at all. And having tasks that an individual can relate to may actually change our findings. Where a lot of work traditionally finds that children who have experienced adversity will score lower on various cognitive tasks than their non-adversity exposed peers, a recent paper by Young and colleagues in 2022 found that this performance gap actually closes when the items used in a task are relatable, like people or money, rather than abstract, like shapes. So there's a danger of misrepresenting developmental phenomena as a function of the tasks that we use with individuals in our lab. I was drawn to developmental research because it felt like a way that I could make a positive change for every member of society, even the little ones. Research has the ability to inform so many proposed policy items with the potential to enrich child development and make sure that children grow up into happy and healthy adults. These are policies like paid maternal leave, humane policies for immigrant families, affordable health care, access to education, and support for mental health that can improve so many lives. However, with non-representative samples and disconnected tasks that are often used in research, we are oftentimes neglecting the people that may benefit the most from some of these policies. That's why it's critical to get to know participants as people. We can ask families and children about their daily lives and how they feel coming into the lab. We can then use what we learn going forward in our careers and represent children and families in research and, in turn, in policy. As scientists, we have to remember that every data point in a paper is a child and a family with their own lives, their own fears and concerns, and their own favorite dinosaurs, and constantly remind ourselves of this as we do research to build a better world for children. Thank you.